चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्य मनोदिष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले
रूपा कदा मायं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीपदकमलं श्रीगुरोन्वैष्णवश्च रूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं चैतन्यदेवं राधाकृष्णपदान् सहगण ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिन्धो दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तु ते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी ऋषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे सो थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस in this first time we're holding in the home of Bankim Rai Prabhu and Hema Mataji. This road is also very auspicious. You would have seen the name. What's the name of this road? Love Grove. What does it remind you of? Kunja Bihari. If you're not named the house, then you can call it Kunja Bihari. Have you named the house already? No? Oh, there you go. And your name reminds us of Banke Bihari. So if you have deities, there will be Banke Bihari. Yeah, very auspicious that you have moved close to the new temple. The more devotees that come closer to the new temple, the more quickly the Lord will come. That is the secret. The Lord doesn't really like Madras Hill. He doesn't like Sydney. But he loves the devotees. So it's very nice that devotees are buying land and still affordable this area. I believe we can get land 500,000 or even less. So still affordable. You can, within a million you can construct a house, big house for Krishna. And these homes will be the base for programs to start. So today we have a Schofield's Hall program again in the evening. So we are trying to, as you know, gather all the devotees around this area. Some old devotees, some new devotees, all together. So that there is spreading of Krishna consciousness actively in this region. So we have a big community. By the time the temple opens, we'll have a nice community. We not only need money, we also need volunteers, we need devotees. Bigger temple, bigger responsibility. Mathura Gokul Mataji, she's doing the rosters for small temple and it's so hard, isn't it? In a new temple, everything you have to multiply by 4 or multiply by 8 even. So we need at least 4 Mathura Gokul Matajis. Because this is keeping her busy full time, not sitting. We need another 4 to expand. So it's a big job. That's why this Bhakti Shastri, I'm saying this because you are the leaders, you are the future and you are the pioneers of this a new temple. You will be the main devotees in the new temple. So this will be your responsibility. And that's why everyone needs to step up and take more responsibility. And we have many Bhakti Rishas here, Bhakti Shastris here, which is wonderful. And these devotees, when they finish Bhakti Vriksha, they are ready to start their own Bhakti Vriksha. They study Bhakti Shastri, but they lead a Bhakti Vriksha like that. So there is an ongoing progression and growth in all directions. And that way we have a strong community here. And the bigger, the better the community, the faster the temple will come up and the faster the preaching will spread all over Sydney. I mean, look back 5 years ago. Sudhir Prabhu was there, right? Quite different, isn't it? The whole dynamics have changed now. And all because every devotee is preaching. Everybody is preaching. That's right. If you have one or two preachers doing the preaching and everyone else relax, the movement is not going to spread. I'm in Wellington now, that's what they're telling me. A lot of potential, but no one is preaching here. And last night, the congregation preaching head, he spoke to me and said, "Everyone, there's a lot of potential. We want to do it, but there's no one is doing it. Everyone thinks someone else will do it. Or they feel they're not qualified, or they feel they don't know what to do." So I said, next 3 to 6 months, if I'm there, I can get some service. That'll be nice. So we can. So Sydney has to not only lead the way, but you also have to be a role model. Another responsibility, because other temples are looking up to us. Adelaide, Perth, Brisbane, Cairns, Townsville. Right, Townsville? And possibly now New Zealand. And Hong Kong, and so many places. So we want to make this really work properly. We need all the help. Everybody is important, nobody is unimportant. Now don't think I'm speaking out of topic, that's related to today's topic. Just in case you thought, because today's topic is about Vyabhicharena, Mamshabhicharena, Bhakti Yogena Sevati. This is undivided devotional service. And that is what is required to spread the movement. And the glory is that every one of us can participate in that. Everyone has a role to play. No one is insignificant or unqualified. The only disqualification is our own lack of desire. Our lack of desire is the only disqualification. No matter whether you're young like Shankar or old like me, it doesn't matter. Everybody can participate, everyone can contribute and make our life really successful, really, really successful. It's such a wonderful feeling when you feel the Lord is reciprocating with you. And it's such a wonderful feeling, it's priceless. Your life is now successful, that's it. There's nothing greater than that. What more do you want? Radha Gopinath is personally reciprocating with you. What more do you want? Tell me. Can there be a greater honor, a greater pleasure, a greater satisfaction when the Lord is reciprocating with you? By mercy of Srila Prabhupada, mercy of Guru, of course, you can't go to Radha Gopinath directly. You have to always be mindful of that. But the fact is still, Radha Gopinath is reciprocating with us. That's a fact. Through the parampara. And that is the wonderful place to be in. And that is the success of our human life. That is real success. If I had to leave this world one day, then you can say, good, my life has been very happy, very useful to myself and to others, hopefully. And Krishna has used me as an instrument, even though I'm so unqualified. And that's what today's verse is going to bring out, that point, how wonderful it is to be transcending the three modes. See, already in the spiritual world, even though we are in a material world, we are out of it already. Why you talk about going back to Godhead? You are already back to Godhead. There's no need to go anywhere. You are already there. And that's where the first thing that attracted me to this movement, because every other person would say, end of life, you are a good boy, you'll go to heaven. You're a bad boy, you go to hell. And that's all I was told. I said, end of life, but what about now? I want to see something now. I want to feel something now. And who knows whether heaven really exists or not. And if it exists, who knows whether it's really as good as you're advertising. How do I know? No one come back and said, hey, it's great, you're sending a postcard saying, what a wonderful holiday, come back here. We don't hear about that. In fact, one Prabhupada disciple, he was on his deathbed, but he's not passing away. He couldn't be alive, he couldn't pass away. He was like in that state. And he was struggling like this for months. And devotees also struggling, trying to help him. And they're trying their best. And it was very hard for everyone. So one day morning he woke up. Did I tell this? One day morning he woke up and he said, I'm ready to go. And everybody said, why suddenly you decided today you want to go? He said, last night I had a dream. In my dream my godbrother told me, who's already passed away. He said, it's very wonderful with Prabhupada here. Come, don't hesitate. We are with Prabhupada, we are serving Krishna nicely. Don't be afraid, just come. So that convinced me. I'm ready to go. So like that, for a devotee, coming or going, it's inconsequential. So every situation in life, we can see disadvantages and feel depressed. Or we can see the advantages and feel ecstatic. So every situation, that is Vyabhicharena. That is Vyabhicharena Bhakti we are talking about today. To be able to, I will discuss more. I got a little inspiration today. So I'm just speaking from that I'll share with you. But I will read this verse today. So Arjuna asked three questions in text 21. Very good. What are the three questions he asked? What are symptoms of one who's transcended three modes? And the second is behavior. And the third is how does he do it? Okay, three questions. And the first two are answered in text 22 to 25. Which we'll recap today so that stays in our head. And the last question is answered in text 26, which we'll read today. So we'll just read through 22 to 25 and then we shall go to 26. So maybe Mataji, Shivali Mataji can start off. Read one verse each in Sanskrit. We'll just pass it along. Text 22. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Shri Bhagavan
Uvacha.
Prakasham cha
pravrittim
cha.
Mohameva cha Pandava.
Nadveshti sampravrittani. Na nivrat. Nivritani kanshati.
Nivritani kanshati. Next, Manibhushthavati.
Udashina vad ashino.
Dasino yat papino.
Gunair yona vichalyate.
Gunair yona vichalyate.
Guna vartanta. Vartanta iti evam.
Guna vartante iti evam.
Yova vatistati nengate.
Yova datati nengate.
Sam duk sukh swastha.
Duk swastha stastastha.
Sam losht ashma kanchana.
Sam losht mat kanchana.
Tulya priya apriya dhira.
Tulya priya apriya dhira.
Tulya ninda atma samastuti.
Tulya ninda sasa samstuti.
Manapamana yostulyas.
Manapamana yostulyas.
Tulyo mitrari pakshayo.
Tulyo mitrari pakshayo.
Sarvaramba parityagi.
Sarvaramba parityagi.
Gunatita sa uchyate.
Gunatita sa uchyate.
The Supreme Personality of God had said, O son of Pandu, he who does not aid illumination, attachment and delusion when they are present or long for them when they disappear, who is unwavering and undisturbed through all these reactions of material qualities, remaining neutral and transcendental, knowing that the modes alone are active, who is situated in the self and regards alike happiness and distress, who looks upon lump of earth, a stone and a piece of gold with an equal eye, who is equal to both the desirable and undesirable, who is steady, situated equally well in praise and blame, honor and dishonor, who treats alike both friends and enemy, and who has renounced all material activities, such a person is said to have transcended the modes of nature.
Very good. So we discussed last time elaborately these qualities, and we had asked devotees to do homework where you describe the role models for these qualities from Srila Prabhupada, from Lord Chaitanya, from current devotees also, contemporary devotees. So it was a very well enlivening experience. So those who are not present last week, maybe this is the last chance. You can present any qualities if you are prepared, if you have done homework and didn't get a chance to present last time. Is there anyone who would like to present any of these qualities which Rasananda Prabhu just read? Anybody? Okay, if nobody is there, then we go to the next verse. Yes, someone is there? Ruchika, yes, see now. Someone had to dub you in. Someone had to dub you in. She's saying like Baad mein dekh lungi. For those who don't understand Hindi, I'll see you later. No, this is transcendental, don't worry. We are transcending the modes. One way to transcend the modes. Yes, you are both. Microphone. It's a bigger hall, you need microphone.
Just a thought, Prabhu, over here. Last time, you know, when we were discussing the examples, there were a lot of examples that on about Maharajas, all our Maharajas, and we were discussing about them. One of the things that just came to my mind later on was that, I mean, if you really see the, and you know, I read Radharat Maharaj's book as well, over there, what, it's disturbing, what I realized was that the position that Maharajas are there today, they have really earned it, in the sense that at one point they are totally surrendered to Krishna. And not just they are totally surrendered today, but if you really see, they absolutely, like if we read the journey back home, he was in the Himalayas, right? And he was totally surrendered, nothing on him at all, not a single, just a piece of cloth maybe, and that's it. And that's the story of every Maharaj that is there. So they have really earned it, and they've come to the level today, and the respect that we see, outsider may see the Maharaj and feel, oh, they are living in such comfort, but that is not the case. They are totally surrendered souls, and that's why they are there today. And so they have totally transcended, in other words, the three modes of material nature. So
yes, very good point, Prabhu. That's why the gold and pebble makes no difference, right? A piece of stone and gold makes no difference, because living in comfort, they're still Krishna conscious. Discomfort also, they're Krishna conscious. And they've been tested in both cases. They've been tested. It's not that they haven't been tested. So even if they're being looked after by hundreds of devotees and a lot of facilities now caring for them, but still they're not affected by that. They're still continuing the Krishna consciousness. They're still dependent on Krishna. Because our tendency is, you brought up a very good point, our tendency is when things are comfortable, we don't feel need Krishna anymore, we don't need to surrender as much, we take comfort in those facilities we have around us, wealth, family, house, health even, health, our bodies. We take satisfaction from these things and depend less and less on Krishna. So when these are taken away all of a sudden, which eventually happens, then we are not in a good position to be Krishna conscious. Then our Krishna consciousness gets challenged. Because then we start doubting Krishna, why did you take away my comforts? You are not being fair to me. You are not looking after me. And that is such an important point. Because when the facilities are there, we tend to enjoy those facilities and not think of it coming from Krishna, not think of giving back to Krishna. That's why I remember the Vyas Puja offering His Holiness Bhakti Charu Maharaj wrote a few years ago. He said, we are just enjoying the hard work of Srila Prabhupada. The facilities of ISKCON, we're getting all the respect, we're getting all this reciprocation from so many devotees, from the community. We're enjoying all that. We're just enjoying it. We didn't work for it. Prabhupada worked for it. We simply enjoy. Of course, he's taking a very humble position. We know that he also and current ISKCON Guru Vrinda, they're doing tremendous service, unparalleled service. And whatever Srila Prabhupada gave them, they've taken it to the next level. Like Prabhupada opened 108 temples in the last 11 years of his life. Now he's gone to more than 500. and growing. And Sydney is going to get another temple now. So there is a lot of potential. If we all put our hearts together and say, we're going to make it happen, it's going to happen. And so this chapter is teaching us this important lesson. Whether you get gold or you get a stone, you have to be transcendental. You have to be transcendental three modes. Shouldn't get carried away by those. Because the moment we think it's mine for enjoying, immediately the modes will take over. Then it's not transcendent anymore. And then depending on what mode we are, we'll try to enjoy goodness, passion, ignorance. The enjoyment will try to come in all the three forms, either goodness, passion or ignorance, depending on how we are situated. And it's, that means we are caught in the modes, back into the material world. Our consciousness is not transcendental anymore, it's not Krishna conscious anymore. Did I mention this last time? Of the six opulences of Krishna, we also have six opulences of Krishna, to a minute degree, of course. We know that. And of these six opulences, five opulences can be given to us any moment and taken away any moment. Wealth. We have wealth today. Isn't it guaranteed to last forever? Beauty? Definitely not. Health, strength, definitely not. Knowledge, anything can happen, you can lose it. Fame, very easy to lose. Fame can become infamy overnight. The only opulence that no one can take away from us is renunciation. And that renunciation is such a wonderful quality, not only no one can take it away from us, it embellishes all the other five opulences. A wealthy man who is arrogant and proud of his wealth is not very attractive. No one likes him. He's an arrogant pig. But if the wealthy man is very humble, very renounced, in spite of being wealthy, that is very attractive. Oh, look at him, he's so simple. He's very wealthy, but he doesn't have the airs of a rich man. Similarly, one who's intelligent, the tendency to be very proud. But if he has renounced and very humble and says, oh, my knowledge is very limited. There's so much to learn. I don't know anything. I wish to learn more. Then immediately that quality becomes embellished. That education, that intelligence, that knowledge he has is respected. Yes, he's such a great person. He knows so much, yet he's so humble. He's not showing off his knowledge, little knowledge he has. So renunciation is a quality that actually embellishes all the qualities. And Krishna has it in full. He has all the five opulences and he is still the most renounced. And that for us is a clue how we can transcend the modes of material nature. Whether we have something or we don't have something. If you see the bright side of every situation, then you'll be very happy all the time. It doesn't matter. And that's what this chapter is teaching us. So thank you, Srimali Prabhu, for bringing up a very important point. Give the microphone. Yeah. Just repeat it for. Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Can't renunciation be taken away as well?
Can you give an example how renunciation can be taken away?
We read all these leelas mentioned in the scriptures about great sages who were renunciates, but because being affected by the external energy of the Lord, they actually fell down. So renunciation also, correct me if I'm wrong.
Let me explain what is the meaning of the context in which Urmila Mata said that. She said renunciation is something we can take away ourselves. Someone else, third party can't take it away. Wealth, someone else can tell. Stock market will crash or external circumstances. Okay. Whereas renunciation is something we have a choice of either embracing it or rejecting it. That is in our control. Wealth is not in our control. Beauty, fame, all this is not in our control. But this is one thing in our control. We choose to be renounced or we choose to be not renounced, attached. That is our choice. No one can force you to be renounced. No one can force you to be not renounced. No third party can bring that to you. Whereas all other things are circumstantially based. Though
of course, indirectly you may say that renunciation also can be taken away. That's like some, there's a temptation that comes in front of you and you go tempted to invest money in a bad deal or something and lose all your money. And then, you know, that circumstance makes you very attached to your money and you may lose the money or something. But again, those are all things that we have a choice in. We always have a choice of being renounced. Because the perfection of renunciation, which is going to come in the last chapter of the Gita, is to understand everything belongs to Krishna. Then renunciation comes very naturally. If we can, of course, theoretically we know that, but practically we don't. We don't follow that. No? We don't live like that. We live like everything belongs to me. And I am out of generosity giving something to Krishna. That's my, look at me, I'm such a great devotee. Rather, it was never asked in the first place. So that is chapter 18 is perfection of renunciation. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that is true. Ultimately, you see, we have free will. We have free will. Because the where his free will went wrong was he was out of the association of devotees. That's where the problem started. The deer was a symptomatic of the problem. What the real problem was, Prabhupada explains that he didn't have the association of devotees. He was alone. That's why he stresses so much performing devotional service in the association of devotees. That's very important. If we do our own independent scene, that's not going to give us the same advancement as we do devotional service in the association of devotees. That's the problem. Yeah.
The choice is yours.
Always that freedom Krishna has always given. Yeah. Huh? That freedom Krishna has always given. Ultimately, there's only one freedom Krishna has given us. And that freedom is whether to surrender to him or not. That's it. One decide not to surrender, then the three modes take over. And three modes we act in a certain way. Like Bharat Maharaj, he got attracted to the deer, the modes took over. In the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is showing signs of getting into the modes in the first chapter. Where his mode of goodness is troubling him. And he wants to not kill so many people. So, again, the renunciation there is questioned. So, your point is good. That Markandeshi point example is exemplifying that choice is always with us. It only confirms the point. That's that what you're saying it, right? To confirm the point, yeah. So, rather than see it as a conflict, it's not a conflict. It's a confirmation of the same thing. Yeah.
Quite a few years back, Shreyas was doing well in his swimming and he won something and I was so thrilled. I was going through a very tough time at that point of my life. And when I got this news that he had done exceedingly well, I was so excited and I was telling one god sister, oh look, this is what happened. I'm so happy. And she said, Mataji, just tolerate it. I thought, oh my God, why is she asking me to tolerate such good news? And then I came to know, yeah, that's so temporary. So that is when we tolerate happiness and distress, then we are transcending the modes. Mm. So I was very offended, in fact, that she used the word tolerate. But now I know that she was so advanced and she's talking from the Bhagavad Gita, 14th chapter, whereas I was completely under the modes. Yeah, so tolerating happiness and pain.
Very good. Good example. Okay, Ruchika, last call. All right, let's move on. Text 26. Who is next? Bankim Rai Prabhu. She wants to read the Gita, like dad, like mom.
Mamchayo vyabhicharena.
Mamchayo vyabhicharena.
Bhakti yogena sevate.
Bhakti yogena sevate.
Sagunam samityatyam.
Samgunam samatityaityan.
Brahma Bhuyana Kalpate.
Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate.
Translation. One who engages in full devotional service, unfailing in all circumstances, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahma.
Very good. So, Jagannath. Purport.
Purport. This verse is a reply to Arjuna's third question. What is the meaning of attaining to the transcendental position? As explained before, the material world is acting under the spell of the modes of material nature. One should not be disturbed by the activities of the modes of nature. Instead of putting his consciousness into such activities, he may transfer his consciousness to Krishna activities. Krishna activities are known as Bhakti Yoga, always acting for Krishna. This includes not only Krishna, but his different plenary expansions such as Rama and Narayana. He has innumerable expansions. One who is engaged in the service of any of the forms of Krishna or of his plenary expansions is considered to be transcendentally situated. One should also note that all the forms of Krishna are fully transcendental, blissful, full of knowledge and eternal. Such personalities of Godhead are omnipotent and omniscient, and they possess all transcendental qualities. So if one engages himself in the service of Krishna or his plenary expansions with unfailing determination, although these modes of material nature are very difficult to overcome, one can overcome them easily. This has already been explained in the 7th chapter.
Okay, what is that verse in the 7th chapter? What am I? Mama Maya? Mameva Prapadante? Amitam? So that material nature is very hard to cross over. Why it's hard is explained here. There he says difficult to cross over. But why is difficult? Now what can you say? Why is it difficult to cross over? Because? Yeah, one who surrenders can cross over, but why is it difficult to cross over? What's the reason? Because the modes are there. Exactly, thank you. Because three modes are binding us all the time, isn't it? What's the nature of the binding explained here? Okay, what we'll do is, it's a big purport. Raghav can read the next part. You can chant later, Raghav. Because in my class, it'll be difficult to hear in the holy name and Gita. It's hard to put both. Yeah, no problem. One who surrenders. Seventh chapter is mentioned. It's already been explained as 7th chapter.
One who surrenders unto Krishna at once surmounts the influence of the modes of material nature. To be in Krishna consciousness or in devotional service means to acquire equality with Krishna. The Lord says that his nature is eternal, blissful and full of knowledge, and that living entities are part and parcel of the Supreme, as God particles are part of a golden mine. Thus the living entity in his spiritual position is as good as God, as good as Krishna in quality. The difference of individuality continues, otherwise there would be no question of Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga means that the Lord is there, the devotee is there, and the activity of exchange of love between the Lord and devotee is there.
Okay,
therefore,
okay, you can hand over to Shankar in a little bit as well.
Therefore, the individuality of two persons is present in the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the individual person, otherwise there would be no meaning to Bhakti Yogi. Yoga, if one is not situated in the same transcendental position with Lord, one cannot serve the Supreme Lord. To be a personal assistant of to a king, one must acquire the qualification. Thus, the qualification is to become Brahman, freed from all material contamination. It is said in the Vedic literature, Brahma Vivyan.
Brahma eva san brahma api eti.
Brahma eva san brahma one can attain the supreme Brahman to becoming Brahman. This means that one must qualitatively become one with Brahman. By attainment of Brahman, one does not lose his eternal Brahman identity as an individual soul.
Very good. Thank you. So what's the main point here? Shankar and Raghav first. Maybe Raghav can speak first. Any one point is fine. Just make it. There are many points, just pick any one.
So, if someone engages in devotional service, they bypass the mode of material nature and they come to the level of Brahman.
Very good. Thank you. You got the main point. Thank you. Good on you, Raghav.
One who's engaged in service is transcendentally situated.
Very good. Excellent. Now you know why we do service. Good. Good boys. Both of you did well. Anybody else would like to add to that? What are the points? Yes, Nangogulko. Microphone.
Prabhu, for to overcome the transcendental mode or be into the transcendental mode or do the bhakti yoga, there has to be three entities, Lord, you and the service. So unless and until you do some service, there will not be any connection between you and the Lord. So service is the thing which actually connects you and the Lord together.
Yes. Very good. Yes, please. Rajika, you got a microphone.
Prabhu, the point that is written here, to be in Krishna consciousness or in devotional service means to acquire equality with Krishna. Someone who is a Mayavadi or is an impersonalist will think that, you know, you can actually become God. But it's the point is clarified here later on that, you know, that one can become qualitatively equal with the Lord, but quantitatively we cannot be equal with the Lord. We can only serve Him.
Yes, very good.
Example given is the gold mine and the gold particle, where the gold particle has the quality of the gold but is not the same as gold.
Very good. Excellent. Yes.
The individuality of both the Lord as well as the living entities has been very clearly established that, you know, you can never merge with the Lord, you know, you cannot become one with the Lord, you know, both are individual and that identity has to remain always.
Yes, very true. And unless the identity is there, there is no question of service and there is no question of relationship also. For relationship, there has to be two. You can't have relationship with yourself. You need someone to have relationship with. So that's why the individuality is stressed here. Very good. Okay. Any other points?
The power of service is mentioned here. So if you serve with unfailing determination, that helps us to overcome the modes.
Yes. Very good. Yes. Yeah, please.
In this purport here, Prabhu, it is said that this includes not only Krishna, but His different planetary expansions, such as Rama and Narayana.
Yes.
So, one who engages in the service of any forms of Krishna or of His planetary expansion is considered to be transcendentally situated.
Yes.
So, any form of Krishna is alright. I mean, someone is worshipping Rama, someone is worshipping Narasimha.
Yeah.
They will finally go back to Krishna.
That is considered devotional service. That's what Prabhupada is saying. Any form of the Lord. Yeah. So they are no less potent because they are Vishnu Tattva. Therefore, serving them is equally powerful. But not only that, Mother Parvati asked the question of Lord Shiva, I am serving you, I am not serving Vishnu. What is my position? And that's the famous verse, Aradnam Sarvesham Vishnu Aradhanam Param Tasmat Paratram Devi Tadiyanam Tamarchanam. So Tadiyanam is the associates of the Lord. You serve any of the devotees of the Lord, that's also the same. Sakshat dharitvena samasta shastre. Uktas tata bhavyate vibhat sadbhi. So,
The spiritual master is the direct representation of Krishna, Sakshadhari. So therefore, he gives a clue, because you serve the Lord, he may not reply to you, say whether he liked it or not, whether he's happy or not, you don't know. But spiritual master can give feedback. So Krishna's representative serving is also very important. So Tadiyanam Samarchanam, Lord Shiva says, yes, you're worshipping, serving a devotee of the Lord, then you're serving me. On the other hand, one who worships the Lord in the temple but does not serve the devotees is considered a Kanishta Adhikari, neophyte devotee. So the expansion of the Lord also like that. Having said that, the Sampurna, the full rasa is only present in Krishna's original form, Shamsundar form. All the rasas are present. While all are transcendental, but if you come to the subject of rasa, the intimacy of the rasa in Krishna is complete. All rasas are there. He is called Rasaraj. All the rasas are there in Krishna. He can reciprocate at every level. Whereas Lord Ramchandra, he has not a personal limitation. He chooses to not manifest the full form of the Lord, full potency of the Lord, the full rasa, exchange of rasa is not complete in all the other incarnations. There is a distinction. But nevertheless, they are all transcendental. Hanuman is no less transcendental than Arjuna. And they both are pure devotees. But the intimacy is different. That makes sense? Yeah. But they're all transcendental. That we don't dispute. Sometimes people ask, oh, I'm serving Vishnu, I'm not serving Krishna. Yeah, they're still transcendental. All the old temples you see, Sri Rangam and Guruvayur and all these temples, they're worshipping forms of Vishnu, Narayana form, the Lord. Of course, there the worship is done with awe and reverence. And the intimacy is not the same as with Radha and Krishna. But we aren't on that level anyway, so better we start. Even a Radha Krishna deity, Prabhupada said, in our temples, we should worship in the mood of Lakshmi Narayana, not in the mood of Radha Krishna, in their Madhuri Rasa. That's not. Well, we should always take the position of a Dasya Rasa, servant, and serve in that mood. So that's why Prabhupada says, in any of those forms, they are equally potent, omnipotent and omniscient, so therefore they are worshipable. In that sense, of course, the question comes about Buddha. What about those who worship Buddha? That's an exception. That is an exception. Lord Buddha, he rejected the Vedas, he rejected the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So those who render worship to him in the nectar of devotion, Rupa Goswami explains, that is not considered devotional service because of rejecting the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Whereas other forms, they don't reject the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the worshippers of other forms, and therefore they are considered transcendental. Similarly, Jarasandha, he worshipped Lord Vishnu. He had shaligrams at home, he worshipped. But he was inimical to Krishna. Therefore, that's also not considered devotional service. So there are some exceptions. But otherwise, all other Prahlad Maharaj or Hanuman or any of the great devotees, Dhruva Maharaj, they're all considered great devotees. All transcendently situated. Though they didn't start off transcendently situated. They were not like that to start in Narad Muni as well. They didn't start off like that. But they ended up in the transcendental position by the power of devotion service. And that's when Narad Muni describes his own life in the fifth chapter of the first canto. He describes his own life to Vyasadeva. The reason being not to show off his own achievement, but rather to show the power of devotion service. See, I was son of a maid servant. What was that? Before that I was a Gandharva. I was singing Bollywood songs and got cursed. What is my position? He unabashedly admits and confesses his good side as well as his dark side. Of course, Narad Muni is a Nitya Siddha associate also, but he is showing the example of a Sadhana Siddha. So that is for us to emulate. Yeah? Thank you. Good question. Buddha is a Shaktivesh avatar, but because he rejected the Vedas and because he rejected the Supreme Personality of Godhead, And therefore, following Buddha is not considered devotional service. Lord Buddha tricked his followers, Prabhupada explains, by his charisma. He is very charismatic. So he tricked them into giving up killing of animals and following him. At least ahimsa was there. Because previously in the name of religion, they was doing himsa. There was a lot of violence against the animals. And Buddha wanted to stop that. So that with that intention, he told them, forget the Vedas, just reject the Vedas. But if you follow Lord Buddha, we will not be doing devotional service because devotional service, to have to accept the Supreme Personality of Godhead, that's required. The Lord has to be the Bhokta, Bhoktaram Yagyatapasam, Sarvaloka Maheshwaram. We have to accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If you don't accept the supremacy of the Lord, then that service we render is not devotional service. Any philosophy that rejects the Supreme Personality of Godhead is atheistic. And therefore, service done to that mood, to that personality, is no longer transcendental. But Buddha's purpose was to save people from going to hell. At least he saved them from going to hell. But what he offered was not devotional service, it was something less. In fact, it was spiritual suicide actually. Because losing individuality, based on this verse, you can see, is you lose your spiritual identity, that's spiritual suicide. Prabhupada said two kinds of suicide, material suicide and spiritual suicide. Material suicide, you lose the body. But spiritual suicide, you lose your identity as a part and parcel of Krishna. And that is far more serious. So Buddhism ultimately leads to voidism, which is atheism. Therefore cannot be accepted as devotional service. It is not anukulena, Krishna anushilnam. It doesn't fall in that category. Therefore the definition of bhakti rejects the process. Has to be anukula, favorable to the Lord. If you are rejecting the Lord, why is Krishna being favorable? You are saying God doesn't exist. So how can he be favorable to the Lord? That is the worst kind of offense, isn't it? If someone says to you, Mataji, you don't exist, that's the most humiliating thing you can tell someone. No question of saying you're good or bad, you just don't exist. And that is the worst form of atheism. Yeah, because he is avatar, but his purpose is different. Prabhupada says the need of the hour philosophy, that was the need of the hour. So at that point, Krishna had to do some emergency action to bring people away from killing animals and going to hell, to bring them at least to the path of non-violence. From where they can start thinking and understanding higher philosophy. That's why the philosophy has been given in stages. Shankaracharya came and established still atheism, but with at least Brahman, Brahman Satya. Buddha said nothing Satya, everything Mithya. Shankaracharya said, Brahman Satya Jagan Mithya. Material world is Mithya, but spiritual world, Brahman is real. But the very greatness of Brahman he did not reveal. So his philosophy is also atheistic. Because anyone who denies Supreme Personality of Godhead is an atheist. Krishna nahi mane, daitya kori jane. Krishna has come and goes, he puts it black and white. Sounds very fanatical statement. If you go and say it outside, people think, oh, they are all right, Krishna is a fanatic. But that's what it is really. Krishna nahi mane, daitya kori jane. We consider him as a demon. All atheistic. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada says in one of the lectures hearing this morning that our society is the only institution that is providing opportunity for pure devotional service. Nobody else. They're all cheating. He said, they're all cheating. Very openly says it. Because anyone who falls short of pure devotional service, they're cheating. They give you karma, karma kanda, jnana kanda, upasana kanda, they are all cheating. Sakale vishayara bhanda. Chaitanya Charitamrita. No, it is demigod worship mainly. Upasana is, Pancharatrik is deity worship. Narada Pancharatrik we follow, that is deity worship. Upasana kanda is mainly demigod worship. Performing sacrifices, so in the next life will be going to heaven. It does, but it is very covered. That's why Vyasadeva felt dissatisfied after compiling the Vedas. It is not very openly given. In the Agamas, it is there. There is Narayana, thing, Upanishad, and there is Taittiri Upanishad. In that, there are so many suktas are there. Like Narayana Sukta, Vishnu Sukta, Lakshmi Sukta, Shri Sukta, there are so many Pancha Suktas. They all glorify the Lord. But it's done in a way that is not so obvious. Yeah, yeah. They are part of the Upanishads, part of the Vedas. Taittiriya Upanishad has got most of the suktas. Taittiriya Upanishad. So they are all glorifying the Lord ultimately. Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha. That's the Sahasra Shirsha, thousand heads. Purusha is a person. The Lord is a person, not impersonal. So that's why, unless we accept the personality of Godhead, there is no question of accepting devotional service. And there is no question of accepting our individuality as part and parcel of Krishna. All three are to be there. They are all eternal. So Prabhupada says they are all eternal. Individuality? In service. It'll go beyond, it'll go to Bhagavan realization. You can't render service to Brahman, right? There's no way of serving Brahman. How do you serve Brahman Jyoti? You can't. But service means, that's what you mentioned earlier, right? Three things. The servitor, the Lord, and the service. All three are eternal. The Lord is eternal. Therefore, being a part and parcel, we are eternal. And therefore, any service done on that platform is eternal. That's the Prabhupada makes another point in the purport, that one has to be, we can't serve the Lord from the modes of material nature, because he is on a spiritual platform, you are on the material nature, you are on a different platform. You cannot serve the Lord. One has to transcend the modes in order to engage in devotional service. Brahmabhuta prasannatma nasochati nakangshati. Samasavresh bhuteshu mad bhaktim labhate param. So that transcending has to be there. One, as long as you are in the modes, you cannot approach the Lord because he is in the different platform. That's why people are saying, show me God, they can't see, because they're trying to see from a material platform. He's on a different platform, how can you see? It's not possible. He's trying to use a microscope to see Pluto, you can't. You need a telescope for that. And using a telescope to look at a bacteria, you can't see the telescope. There's a wrong instrument. So this material body is a wrong instrument. And you're saying, oh, nothing is there, it's all good. No, you didn't see anything. That's the problem. So the devotional service has to be on the spiritual platform. So the devotee, when he engages in devotional service, he transcends the modes, at once transcends the three modes, material nature. Any other points?
Hare Krishna. Prabhu, talking of this material world being an insurmountable ocean, you know, because of the three modes of material nature, and how difficult it is to cross beyond it, and how easy it becomes when you actually surrender unto the Lord.
Yeah.
Just wanted to, mention something that, it's a very famous verse from the Bhagavatam, Samashrita hi pad pallav plavam, Mahat padam puni yasho murare, Bhav ambudhi vats padam, param padam, padam padam yad vipadam ratesha. It's a beautiful verse.
Yes.
Just to explain the meaning, for someone who is actually taken the shelter of the boat of the lotus feet of the Lord who is actually the shelter of this entire cosmic manifestation, he is supremely pious and he is known as the enemy of the demon Mura. To that person, this material world, the existence, you know, this material existence is actually like the water contained in a calf's hoof print.
Very nice.
And and parampadam is like, and for that person, the actual destination is the supreme destination called the Vaikuntha, which is without any miseries, and not the one where padam padam yat vipatam, and not the one where there are miseries at every step. It's a beautiful verse. Yes. It's from the 10th canto in the Bhagavatam.
Prabhupada quotes that quite often. Yeah, at least the last part, padam padam yad vipadam.
Padam padam. And it's beautifully explained, sir.
Yeah.
And that's actually what the case is. There are miseries at every step in the material world.
Yeah.
Unless you surrender unto Him, I mean, there is no way that you can, you know, actually think of crossing beyond
it. Yeah, we want to be comfortable here in the material world without surrendering to Krishna. That's the problem. When the surrender is there, it's actually, Krishna makes it very easy. That's, very good verse. Yeah. Chanmukhi?
I remember, I thought of three different points. Here it says, unfailing in all circumstances, one who engages in full devotional service, unfailing in all circumstances. Sorry, I'm talking about my Gurudev. You're not supposed to talk about your Gurudev, but then this is a very applicable point. So I thought, once when Gurudev was attacked in Madrid in Spain, one person cut his throat and he was... It just missed his jugular vein by a few centimeters, and so he was still able to speak. Those times, when he was still recuperating, he was strictly advised not to talk. So he couldn't chant. He couldn't chant all his rounds audibly. And so he was in the hospital there. It seems he used to write the Maha Mantra 1728 times every day. And he would call a few devotees and ask them to sign on that paper saying that they have witnessed that he has done his rounds.
Mm-hmm.
So that is unfailing in all circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
So when we take Diksha, we promise our spiritual master, I will chant the Maha Mantra every day for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm.
So there is Srila Prabhupada is showing us how to put the Bhagavad Gita into practice.
Mm-hmm.
So that was one point for unfailing in all circumstances. Avyabhicharena. And then I was thinking of another thing. How Prabhupada talks about qualitatively being one with the Lord in the purport. He's emphasized that. Usually what we do is we get so scared of mentioning how we are qualitatively equal. Because we feel, we'll become proud. We'll get carried away by it. So we only emphasize on the quantitatively small and we forget the qualitatively equal. But if we keep remembering that we are qualitatively equal with the Lord and work towards that, because of course now we are not qualitatively equal because we are so conditioned. And so bhakti is the process of removing that conditioning and coming to that position where we are qualitatively equal. So whenever our mind plays up and we get caught up thinking, oh my God, why is this happening to me? Or I'm so angry, I'm so whatever. So then instantly, if we can instantly, but it doesn't happen instantly because the modes are so strong. So someone, when they were told, oh, Maya is so strong, they said, no, you are weak.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can instantly remember who we really are, then it becomes so easy to transcend the modes. I think I already told this once, but then I don't mind repeating it because then it gets hammered in my mind. When His Holiness Bhakti Rasamrita Maharaj had come to Charudeshna Mataji's house, I asked him, Maharaj, in one of the Bhakti Vedanta classes, they said that after you have been in ISKCON for a while, you should start questioning as to who you are in the spiritual world. So I find it quite... I don't even feel that I'm qualified to ask that question. So, for that, Maharaj said, we are still under the modes of material nature. We have still haven't overcome the modes. Then how can we ask who we are? First you transcend the modes, then once you've transcended the modes, then maybe Guru can tell you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this shows, but we shouldn't be disheartened. Instantly we might jump to the conclusion, oh my God, if I'm still under the modes after being so long in ISKCON, then what's the point? But no, it's a very gradual process.
Mm.
For how many lifetimes have we been conditioned? So that long it will take. But if tivrena bhakti yogena yajeta purushamparam. So it should be tivra bhakti yoga.
Mm.
And tivra bhakti yoga doesn't mean quantity, run, do this. It should be quality and... then it should come to quantity, no? So like that, everything boils down to, I hope you don't feel that I'm a stuck, broken record, But then everything boils down to chanting your rounds with attention, with focus, bringing your mind back to it and begging the Lord, Krishna, 90% of us, my spiritual advancement will come from chanting nicely and I'm not doing it properly, Krishna, please help me. Please let me be in the association of devotees who are constantly striving to chant their rounds nicely, to really call out, like His Holiness Gaur Govind Maharaj, when he built the Bhuvaneshwar temple, he said, I've started a crying school here.
Mm.
So all should cry for Krishna. So for that, Mahanidhi Maharaj, he says, okay, come on, let's all practice crying. It's not like that. We should really, really come to understand, like Prabhu said, Padam Padam, that's such a beautiful verse. You explained it so well, Prabhu. It was so beautiful. So Padam Padam Yat Vipadam. So, but if we are just trying to be comfortable here, it becomes very hard, no? And now, going to Wellington, going to Canberra, I'm learning, oh my God. It's really, a rolling stone gathers no moss, no? So, there I'm feeling very happy
what
because...
flying stone?
There, only few things are there, easy. Once you come back here, garden, lawn mowing has to be done, this has to be done, that has to be done. I feel such a burden. I was reminded, so sorry I'm talking so long. I'll only take only one more minute. I was reminded of this drama that they did in Navadvip Mandal Parikrama. And it was Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj's pastime. Someone gave him 1 paisa. Those days 1 paisa was also big. No? So, and he was so all bent like this, one disciple had to carry him. And that person who gave him 1 paisa, he gave it to him and he went away. And Maharaj took that 1 paisa and then he was being carried by the disciple. He told the disciple, run back to that man, carry me and run back to that man. And this disciple just ran carrying the guru and he gave him back that 1 paisa. He said, I don't want the burden of this 1 paisa, it's so heavy, take it back. You know, but then again, being in a woman's body, you know, stree means to to expand. So it comes very naturally, conditioning. But if we try to transcend the modes by clinging on to the lotus feet of the Lord, trying to chant our rounds nicely, Krishna will help. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Ram.
Any other points in the purport you want to cover? There's one more important point which nobody has touched on. Yes, please.
It's written here, if one is not situated in the same transcendental position with the Lord, one cannot serve the Supreme Lord. It is also proved by the fact that, you know, Krishna does not even fight with the people who are who have not been devotees or anything. So even Ravan, Kumkaran or Shishupal and Dantavakra, they were all devotees, they were all Vaikunth Nivasis.
Yes.
In their past lives.
Correct.
So he does not even fight with ordinary people, what to speak of, you know, taking service.
Good point, very good point. Nice realization. Yeah. Yes, Janardhan Prabhu. Is there a microphone there?
Yeah.
Just help,
yeah.
Is
here,
is good?
Here, Prabhu. Yeah, thanks. So one point which strikes me here is what Prabhupada says is, if one is not situated in the same transcendental position with the Lord, one cannot serve the Supreme Lord. And he also asserts on the point that we need to have the qualification.
Yes.
In order to serve
very
the
good,
Lord.
Very good point, yes. And so what is that qualification?
The qualification is that we should not have any material contamination.
Mm, we should come to the same level as
the Lord.
The Lord. And the symptoms of that is said. Becoming Brahman means we don't lose our identity. And that's the qualification. That was the point that was missing. We didn't cover till now. We sort of mentioned but didn't emphasize it. That becoming Brahman doesn't mean lose our identity. We still retain our identity as individuals, as part and parcel of Krishna. Just like a particle of gold and gold mine. Both are the same quality, but the quantity is different. But the individuality of the gold particle is not lost at any point in time.
The Mayavadis like to give example of the rivers pouring into the ocean and lose the identity. But Prabhupada says, to answer that, he says that's not actually true, because the river may pour into the ocean, but the ocean, if you look underwater, you see there's a whole flora and fauna underneath. There are so many fishes and plants and different creatures that exist underwater. It's not free from variegatedness. It's not one big mass of homogeneous substance with no variety. There is a lot of variety underneath. So the Vaishnava, when the river comes into the ocean, it acquires the same quality as the ocean, but the ocean still has it retains its individuality. It doesn't lose its individuality. That is the Vaishnava response to that analogy of the Mayavadis, where they want to destroy that individuality. Prabhupada says in one, it's in a video also, in one conversation he says, they want to make the love of Krishna zero. He says, like, this shows like that, they want to make it zero. When you take away the individuality, you're taking away their love. If you love someone and someone tells you that person doesn't exist, it's not very pleasant, it's not nice, it's very offensive. Similarly, Krishna, for devotees, don't want to hear this. Krishna is not there. Not, or other version is, Krishna is there, but I'll become Krishna. I am that Krishna. The same thing. Same enviousness. Different degrees of enviousness. So becoming one with the Lord, becoming Brahman, doesn't mean we lose the individuality. Individuality is always maintained. So those demons who merge into the form of the Lord, their existence is also not complete, because they have no chance to render service to the Lord. That's why Brahma says in the 10th canto, right? Kaivalyam narakayate. The kaivalya, that merging, is naraka, is like hell for the devotee. Because there's no chance for service. And that we also read last time, Nectar Devotion, Rupa Goswami quotes Hanuman example. He was offered liberation by Lord Ramachandra. He refused. He said, if mukti means I can't serve you, then I don't want mukti. I'd rather be in the material world and serve you than go to mukti, moksha, and no service. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur says same thing. Kitahu janmajar. I don't mind being an insect, but if it's in the house of a devotee. But I don't want to be Lord Brahma. Bahir mukha Brahma nahi kare as. I don't have the asha for desire to become a Bahirmukha Brahma. Brahma is the topmost person in the universe. I don't care for that position if it is Bahirmukha. If it's not transcendental on the platform, not on the Brahman platform, spiritual platform. I don't want Brahma's position also. But I don't mind insect in the house of a devotee. So these are our acharyas, you know, guiding us on this point. So thank you. You made the point that I was looking for. Yes, Nandgokulru.
Wait, I'm in line with the Prabhu's. What Prabhu, I would like, can you please elaborate more on the counter argument what Srila Prabhupada put on the river and the ocean? Because I'm having argument, same argument in the office with one of the person who is Mayavadi. I think he's Buddhist, and he's saying that once you give up all your desire, you'll become God. And you know, he actually quoted me that example. But I couldn't really counter him properly.
Just to add, the same thing. I just wanted to ask Prabhu that if the river is going in the Brahman, river is losing its identity. Ocean is not losing its identity, but no, river salt, no, river sweet water is becoming salty.
That is what we are thinking. But sweet, the salt is also becoming sweet. That sweeter. That's not the scope of the analogy. The analogies are only good up to the parameters that they are meant to cover. You can also argue the ocean losing its saltiness. You could argue, right? If you have salt water in a cup and you pour plain water, the saltiness will reduce, isn't it? Percentage of salt will reduce. It will be less salty. Sometimes you put in a sabji, put more salt. What do? You put more water and boil it. So the sabji will not be so salty. Take away some of the saltiness, isn't it? So like, but that, those are all mundane examples. The main point that we're talking about here is that the river goes in the ocean, yes, but in the ocean there is still identity is there. And a particle of water, even if you argue a molecular point of view, the molecule of river water is still the molecule in the ocean. It does not lost its individuality.
What I actually exactly said, but you
The Prabhupada takes it one step further and says, if you look in the ocean, you see variegatedness there, variety is still there. But a person looking outside from the top will see one whole mass of water, nothing else. But one who looks inside will see, no, there is variety there. So that is the Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan realization. Brahman realization sees only the top of the ocean, sees only water. Paramatma realization goes a bit deeper, it sees there is aquatics. And Bhagavan realization, you see Varuna. The god of the seas, of the ocean, the water bodies. Varuna is also there, Varuna Dev. You go much further into the body of water. But for the first level is only seeing water. That is true, water is there, that's a fact. We don't deny water. But at the same time, you can't deny there are aquatics in the water. Yeah, that's right. And how come God became ungodly? He fell down. That means he's fallible. There are so many faults in the argument. So becoming God, and above all, Prabhupada says, why one become God when God himself is serving his devotee? The devotee is in a better position than God himself. So much so that God himself wants to become a devotee, comes to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So what is inferior about being a devotee? Because the idea is that mundane thinking, material thinking, if I am serving somebody, I am subordinate to somebody, then I am not enjoying. To be an enjoyer, I have to be the bossanu, bossanu, boss. Instead of dasanu, dasanu, dasa. But in the spiritual world, dasanu, dasa is a more exalted position and much happier position. And there is so much nectar that Krishna himself feels, I am missing something. The first time in any shastra we are reading, that God is feeling incomplete. Have you ever heard of that? All say God is great, God is perfect, God is everything. And that is true. But here is a more intimate aspect of the Lord where he is feeling dissatisfaction, that I am missing something. And he has to come as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to fulfill that missing experience. So that shows an individuality. If Krishna himself says, I don't understand what my devotees are feeling for me, I don't fully understand, that means we have to be individuals. Because Paramatma by definition knows what everyone is thinking, what everyone is feeling. Paramatma knows everything. But he doesn't know how devotee feels love for Krishna. It's a contradictory statement. But this is very confidential. People don't understand this with their material thinking. That's the best to give him gulab jamun. Halwa, feed them prasad. Wellington got a good arrangement there. There's a nice restaurant close by. If I go in the evening at 7:30, 8 o'clock when they're closing down, they give all the prasad left over for free. Next day it'll be in the office. I give them some donation, but you know, it's all going to get thrown anyway, so all right. Prasad distribution. Give them lots of prasad. That's the best thing actually. Otherwise by argument we can't establish. Tarka apratishta. We're not so intellectually accept. And even if you're arguing, even if I'm defeated, I won't accept. Kali Yuga people don't accept. At the same time, what you're doing is also correct. You can't let asat being established as the sat, as the truth. You know, we can't let it go like that. We have to stand up and say, no, it's not right. But at the same time, we know that's not going to make them devotees. That itself, in of itself, will not make them devotees. Rather, trick them into doing some devotional service. That is more beneficial for them and for us also. Give them some service, and the easiest service is to take some prasad. Don't tell them it's prasad even, just give them something. Prasad Mathura can make something nice.
Like, probably he's trying the same thing what we are trying. He's trying to call me to their program for. So I have to put up some argument, you know, like I disagree with your philosophy. That.
Yeah, no, you got to tell them. You got to tell them why we don't. Take that philosophy, why it's a spiritual suicide. Read that verse, Kaivalyam Narakayate, 10th canto. Look up that verse and read the purport, it's very nice. Prabhupada quotes that in other places also. In lecture also he mentions that. Yeah. So you can read that verse. Okay.
Prabhu, just going back to the discussion regarding merging into Brahman. When the demons are killed by the Lord, they get Sayujya liberation.
Yeah.
And we also read in the scriptures that a lot of demons,
actually used to be very intimate, at, you know, associate of the Lord in the spiritual world.
Mm.
And the reason why they came, because Lord actually, because he is Rasaraj, he wanted to enjoy all the rasas, you know.
Yeah.
And for example, we rasanas. And because there was nobody in the spiritual world to fight against the Lord, he actually brought some of his intimate associates to the material world.
Correct.
To enjoy those rasas, you know.
Yes.
So, now, so, all, and they actually appeared as demons, you know, Hiranyakashipu and all those.
Yes, yes.
So, although they were intimate associates of the Lord in the spiritual world, they came because the Lord wanted to enjoy the rasas.
Yes.
And now, because they have now been killed by the Lord, you know, the demons have been killed by the Lord, they'll get Sayujya liberation, isn't it? Because that's what, I mean...
Some of them, whereas with the...
And Sayujya liberation being such a degraded thing as you were explaining and as we've learned...
Shishupal and Kamsa are in that category, but Hiranyakashipu and Kashyapu are not in that category. It's a different category.
Okay.
Hmm. There is a difference. Because not all demons get Sayujya Mukti, like... Okay. Putana got the same position as Yashoda. That's the discretion of the Lord. Discretion of the Lord. But you made an important point there, that so because they were associates of the Lord, they went back. They're not just demons. Whereas Kamsa was not an associate of the Lord. He didn't come from that category.
Hiranyakashipu was, you know.
Hiranyakashipu and Aksha were. So that's a different category. Yeah. Putana is a special case.
Yeah. So I was reading, you know, those five excellences of Lord Krishna. And one of the excellences is that, you know, whenever he kills anybody, even the demons, the demons actually merge into him, you know, they merge into his effulgence, you know, which is Sayujya liberation.
Yeah.
And actually thought about, you know, the Hiranyakashipu case, you know, that he used to be, you know, an intimate associate of the Lord.
Yeah.
Just because he came down to help the Lord enjoy that mellow. You know?
Exactly.
And hence he
facilitated that.
He facilitated that. And ultimately he got, you know, he probably got Sayujya liberation, which is not what he wanted.
No, he didn't get Sayujya liberation.
Okay, so
he went back.
So not all demons get Sayujya
liberation. No, not all. See, Putana is another example. Didn't get Sayujya liberation. She got equal to Yashoda. So, but that's the discretion of the Lord. Discretion of the Lord, you see. Because Putana did devotion service. That's the difference. She did two important forms of devotion service. While she was trying to kill Krishna, first she admired the beauty of Krishna before she tried to kill him. First point number one. So that way she had done devotion service. She regretted, why do I have to do this? Then she said, no, I got to do it. And secondly, she offered something to Krishna, even if it's poison. She made an offering, even if it is poisonous. But the Lord, out of his magnanimity, decided it's not poison, it's nectar. And she's my mother. So I'm going to accept it like a mother serving a child. That is Krishna's discretion. We can't put a rule on that and say, therefore he did this. It's his transcendental autocrat. He can do what he wants. But Acharya has explained that these are the two things that brought him, that got her the opportunity to have the same status as Mother Yashoda. Even though materially they're poles apart, completely opposite. And that's why devotees see that as the mercy of the Lord, how he is so merciful. Imagine someone who serves Krishna with love and devotion, how much Krishna will reciprocate with them. Because after all, he is Bhava Grahi Janardana. The Bhava is there, Janardana. You got your hand up.
Through this example that you gave of Putana, is it okay? Has that been completed or? Sorry.
You finished, na?
Prabhu, this example that you gave of Putana, so it's quite possible that you said that it is the Lord's discretion as to whoever he wants, you know, he can give liberation to. But then it's also quite possible for a section of people to take shelter under this, you know, Putana example, saying that, oh, you know, so many things, bad things can be done because of lack of knowledge or ignorance. And still, you know, the Lord may be benevolent. So.
Yeah, Putana didn't do that with the calculation that I will do this and he is going to give me liberation. That was not it was not pre-calculated. Premeditated act of violence is considered more serious than circumstantial violence, even in a court of law. Yeah, ignorance is also, that's the same thing. See, if we are under ignorance and we are doing sinful activity, thinking that I'll get liberated by the Lord, that is not ignorance anymore. We are misusing the knowledge. it ceases to be ignorance anymore. Now we are deliberately misusing that information, that knowledge. That's the seventh offense to holy name, to commit sinful act on the strength of the holy name. You know the holy name is all powerful, non different Krishna. Now I'm committing sinful activity. Yeah, but what I'm saying is, if they're consciously doing it, that's my point. Devotee or non-devotee doesn't matter. If you're consciously doing it with the calculation that if I do this, I'll get this in return, I'll get free from my sin. If that calculation is there, that is an offense. Therefore, that doesn't count. Whereas these are all not premeditated. They were acting according to their modes, according to their desires. And they didn't think of their future. Putana didn't think, if I kill Krishna, what's going to happen to me? In fact, she had killed hundreds of babies before that. She was known. She was a hired killer, baby killer. She was a serial killer, serial murderer. So she was, that was her job. She did that for a living. So she was in ignorance, and she never thought, now I'm going to kill Krishna and that's it, I'll be Yashoda next. No, she never thought like that. I'll be in Yashoda's position. She never thought like Yashoda. When no one can take Yashoda's position like Yashoda. She never calculated like that. It's not a premeditated crime.
Prabhu, as you mentioned, like if we do the calculated, the offenses, that reminded me of Duryodhana when he actually chose Kurukshetra. That was actually deliberately he chose Kurukshetra because even if he loses his life onto the field, he was thinking that I'm going to go. So I was trying to understand that example.
The Duryodhana case and all is different because they died in the presence of Krishna. Anyone who died in the presence of Krishna in the battle of Kurukshetra is not because of Kurukshetra, because Krishna was there, they were delivered. They died in the presence of Krishna. In fact, Bhishma Deva is admiring how the Kauravas are more fortunate because they saw Krishna's face. Whereas the Pandavas, they saw the back of Krishna, Pandava Sena. They were not that fortunate. The Kaurava Sena was more fortunate because they could see Krishna in front and fight. So they were liberated by his presence. Anyone who died in the presence of Krishna, they all got delivered. Krishna said, okay, now this is wholesale, everyone goes. Yeah, it's not different, but still, seeing the smiling face of Krishna, we are personalist, we are not impersonal. So the smiling face of Krishna is more attractive to devotees than the back of Krishna, even though both are the same. Yeah. Like Prabhupada says in the introduction of Gita, that Ganga is purifying, Ganges coming from the lotus feet of Krishna is purifying. And so as the words of Bhagavad Gita coming from his lotus lips are also purifying. In one sense, there is no difference between the toe of the Lord and his lips. But still, the lips are more considered more intimate. So Bhagavad Gita is more intimate than Ganges. While both are transcendental. Achintya bheda bheda tattva. Simultaneously one and different. Manibhushita Mataji had a point to make. We'll conclude with that, it's already one. Question, okay. Microphone for her, please. Sudhir, put behind you. That's all right.
The topic came about Putna.
Mm.
I was wondering because when I saw little Krishna, so many babies were killed before she tried to kill Krishna. And also the six babies of Devaki. Mataji so was killed. So how about those babies? Because they were they were liberated or what? Because she was trying to find out Krishna, right, Putna? And also Kamsa was trying to kill. So how about those babies? Because they were killed because of Krishna. I mean practically. So what about those?
But Krishna brings them back also. Krishna brings them back. Later on, Devaki is released from the jail and Kamsa is killed and Devaki and Vasudev come out. And Krishna recovers those also. He recovers them. But those are there to show us that in order to... That's a very good question because related to today's verse. Because to come to the Brahman platform, one has to be free from those six vices. Six vices are the six children that have to be killed. And then Balaram has to come, Lord Balaram, to, as a guru.
his Adi Guru, original Guru, spiritual masters to come in our life. And then by his following his instruction, perform devotional service, then one can transcend the modes of material nature. Then Krishna will appear in our heart. So that is also explained by Acharyas. But they had a purpose to play. Lust, anger, greed, jealousy, envy, kam, krodh, lobh, moh, matsarya, madness, illusion. Yeah, those six. Then Balaram comes and he purifies the womb. And then Krishna comes. So Balaram was transferred to the womb of Rohini, right? Rohini. Sankarsan is attracted. Yeah. Yeah, they were recurred. Dr. Devaki's desire as a mother, she lost her children, she got back her children. But they had done their role of showing us what we should not do. What we need to, it's a qualification to become Brahman. That's the good, you brought that example. That's a very good example, very suited for this verse. So these are the Prabhupada summarized that by saying, seeing how we, how transcend the modes is that understanding the power of devotional service and understanding Krishna's position as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Understanding that and rendering service by the power of service, the Lord is pleased, then yasya prasada, bhagavat prasada. Then one renders pure devotional service, and by doing that, one can transcend the modes of material nature. Good, very nice. Okay, we are over time now. Thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Shri Prabhupada ki jai. So next week, we are having the Rath Yatra, so there will be no class. We are all going for Jagannath Rath Yatra.